Biden administration officials recently replaced the words woman and mother in favor of the more gender-neutral birthing persons. Critics of the move are gathering this June 24th and 25th for the Summit for Survivors. Organizers say the summit will empower pro-family attendees with persuasive, carefully reasoned arguments, stories from the survivors, and the science from the experts. You can find more information at summitforsurvivors.org.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Welcome to today's special episode of the Dr. J Show. Today, we're doing kind of a pre-game warm-up for our fifth annual Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution to be held in Lake Charles, Louisiana, June 24th and 25th, coming right up. And so today, I've asked three of our speakers, two of whom are receiving awards, to come and join us and just give you all a little bit of a taste of what the summit is going to be like, what you can expect, what kind of people you're going to meet, and why you should get on a plane and come down to Lake Charles. So let's start just by introducing ourselves, everyone, if we may. So I'm going to start with Maria Keffler. And Maria, I'm going to ask each of us, please tell us your name, where you live, and how you know me or the Ruth Institute, how we met, how you know us, just a little bit of that personal history. Just Maria Keffler, tell us about yourself.
I'm Maria Keffler. I'm with Advocates Protecting Children, but I live in Arlington, Virginia. And Dr. J, you invited me on your show. Gosh, has it been, I can't remember now how long ago it's been, but then you invited me to come to the summit last year and give a presentation on what's happening in the schools around sex and gender training in the schools. And so that's how we got introduced. And I've been so grateful for all that you've been doing, pushing back on so many things in the culture that are just so wrong for our kids.
Well, I appreciate that. And I think the way I found you was somehow online. Goodness knows how that works, but I think somehow I found you online and deduced that you were a person that our viewers would want to know about. So that's why I invited you.
Well, it might have been through Erin. I suspect it might have been Erin Brewer that connected us.
Erin Brewer. Well, let's go to Erin Brewer next. Erin, tell people about yourself a little bit.
Hi, I'm Erin Brewer, and I am also with Advocates Protecting Children. I live in Northern Utah. And boy, Dr. J, you have just been a really important person in my life. You reached out to me after I started to speak publicly about my story of being a trans kid and have just been such a huge support to me. So I've learned a lot from you. And since we've, you know, connected so much, it's been really interesting and helpful for me to get the perspective of sort of being a survivor of the sexual revolution. And, you know, the realization that, you know, it all started in 1972 when my parents got a no-fault divorce in California. And you've done such a good job of highlighting how all of these things are part of the, you know, the agenda that's really destroying the family and harming our communities.
Well, I'm glad I found you online, however that happened. Yes, but I do remember kind of seeing you beginning to talk about your story, a number of aspects of your story. And I think we had you on the Dr. J Show maybe like 18 months ago. Yeah. And then we invited you to last year's summit, and you're dynamite. Knowing you has been a real blessing to me as well. So next we have Dr. Quentin Van Meter, straight from his doctor business, Dr. Rounds, and he's still got his stethoscope on. Oh, just to show he's authentic. Okay. No, that's okay. That's okay. I am not that kind of doctor. Okay. I don't own a stethoscope. He's the real deal, everybody. Okay. So Dr. Van Meter, introduce yourself.
I'm Quentin Van Meter, pediatric endocrinologist in private practice in Atlanta for the past 31 years. Prior to that, I had a 20-year career in the Naval Medical Corps as a pediatrician and pediatric endocrinologist. And owe my training in endocrinology at Johns Hopkins to the Navy, who put me through that at their expense so that I could be a pediatric endocrinologist to take care of military service children, which I did until I retired in 1991. I am currently the president of the American College of Pediatricians. I joined them in 2007 while I still maintained my membership in the American Academy of Pediatrics. And then I just couldn't stand the taste of the American Academy of Pediatrics anymore and decided to just have my sole membership in this professional organization, which I currently chair. I am a strong advocate for transgender health care for kids that has very little to do with affirming incongruent gender. I met you, I believe, or someone from your organization at Teens for Truth many years ago, where I think I gave my premier talk on the issue of transgender medicine as it was at the time. And then I've, you know, got on your mailing list and I've watched all the announcements of the meetings. And last year I had the honor of attending the meeting and speaking, meeting your staff and getting to see what a phenomenal organization Ruth Institute is. And I'm excited to be back again this summer.
Well, that's great, Dr. Van Meter. And you and I have another little personal connection that if you don't mind sharing, because I think people will get a kick out of it. Do you want to tell it? Or do you want me to tell it?
You can tell it. It's fine.
Well, okay. So after last year's summit, the summit is kind of a whirlwind. You know, there are a lot of people there, and you participate in everything. But you kind of have to take a breath afterwards and go, I want to catch up with that person, get to know them a little better, and so on and so forth. So after last year's summit, I called you to come and be a guest on the Dr. J Show. And at the end of that show, I said, you know, my dive medicine doctor is also named Van Meter, and Keith Van Meter. And I wonder if you, it's kind of an unusual name. Do you know him? And you said,
he's my brother.
and so I said to you, well, do you know what? I went to him because my doctor here in Lake Charles sent me over to him in New Orleans because I had a dive incident where I actually got the bends on a dive trip. And my local doctor here said, you got to go to Dr. Van Meter in New Orleans. Nobody in Lake Charles knows nearly as much as Dr. Van Meter. You got to go over there. But he hasn't given me my clearance to dive letter. I'm not allowed to dive, even though I'm fine. And so you got on the phone.
I nudged him a little bit and said, hey.
Within hours, I had the letter.
It pays to know the right people, obviously. So.
That's what I concluded, that you are a guy that everyone should know. So, yeah. So now I'd like for people to, each of you to tell a little bit about your organization or your ministry or, you know, whatever it is that that you're doing in this area that's of concern to the Ruth Institute. And let me just go back to Dr. Van Meter. Why don't you start this round, Dr. Van Meter?
I already alluded that I was the president of the American College of Pediatricians. We are a group of board certified pediatricians who stand for scientifically based Hippocratic medical care. That is to say, do no harm above all things, and to base your treatment options and your practice on a moral, ethical medical practice that's scientifically based and not run by political ideology. And that's really important in this day and age. We've had the whole COVID question come up as to whether or not there's ethical issues in vaccination or not, or mask wearing or not, and the science versus the ideologies and all those things that it come up in now a lot of fields of medicine. Politics is playing a giant role in where we're going, and the whole abortion issue and passing a law that would codify abortion as a right and to not allow states to individually have their own opinion is in Congress as we speak. So politics has come to put its giant heel on our neck. And so we in the American College of Pediatricians stand against such things and say, if it is scientifically based, we will go ahead and forge forward and fight for the rights of physicians and the right of conscience. To not do certain treatments, not be mandated by the government to do things that we find ideologically inappropriate for our desire to do no harm. So we are fighting on all fronts. The American College is looking very positively toward pushing for the rights of women to be able to bear children and to take care of those pregnant teens who would otherwise choose abortion as an option. We want to go ahead and push for every option for those young ladies and middle-aged, anybody who would consider an abortion, to give them the alternatives that would save that child's life and allow that child and that life to flourish. So that's one of our pillars, if you will, currently. The other is to do no harm to transgendered individuals, but to guide them through the murky waters and the need for psychological evaluations and counseling to get them to be able to pass through puberty naturally and come to the decision as the vast, vast majority, upwards of 90%, due to come back and to have their gender identity congruent with their biologic sex. And then the third arm is related to the first two, and that is to fight for the rights of conscience so that we do not have entities telling us what to do against our conscience and mandating that by law. So there are pushes on all fronts. We are very busy. I spend at least 3 days a week on conference calls and phones and writing declarations for the states of Alabama and Florida and Virginia in regard to legal cases to protect these children.
Well, and I've seen you online and, you know, behind the scenes and so on and so forth with some of the activity of the American College of Pediatricians, being that voice for sanity in medicine. And I must say that you and your other colleagues in the alternative medical associations, last year we had a whole panel of alternative medical associations, and you guys really opened my eyes. And I would just say, anybody who's considering coming to the summit this year, go right ahead and look at the videos from last year's summit. It'll give you a good flavor of what all goes on. And most of that material, 90% of what we do at the Ruth Institute, is evergreen material. You can learn as much of it from it a year from now as the minute it was produced, because we're dealing with the eternal issues, you know, not the day-to-day politics and stuff like that. As important as that is, that's just not, we're aimed at the core issues. So let's turn to Erin and Maria. You two are partners in crime, we could say, that you two are both in the same organization. Which of you would like to begin by describing your organization?
Why don't you go ahead, Erin?
Okay. Well, Advocates Protecting Children is really, we formed it specifically to do everything we can to protect children from the transgender ideology that's just devastating our youth. And so we do all kinds of things. We have podcasts. We have some books that we've written for parents and for caregivers. We have for the general public who are trying to figure out what's going on. We do a fair amount of legislative outreach. So when legislative actions come along, we submit statements to support children. Mostly we just want to protect these children from these horrible interventions, which include, you know, puberty blockers, which induce developmental delays, cross-sex hormones, which permanently medicalize these kids, and surgeries, and education and outreach is huge. And Marie, do you want to expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, I came to this issue via education. I used to be a teacher and I had my kids in the public schools. And I got a call one night from a friend who said, Maria, I was looking around the Arlington Public Schools website for summer school information, and I came across this transgender student policy working meeting, and it's tonight. I really feel like I should go, but I don't want to go alone. Will you go with me? So I went, and I just had my eyes opened in the most horrific way. A dozen, 15 people sitting around the table talking about what they wanted to see for school policy around transgender issues. And the big takeaway for the evening was that they consider parents to be a threat, that kids need to be protected from their parents, parents need to be kept out of it. And that just shocked and horrified me. And as I started digging into this issue, I spent many nights crying, thinking, realizing what's happening to kids, what's happened to our education. So some of us in Arlington started the Arlington Parent Coalition. I was with that for, gosh, I don't know, a year and a half. And then I met Erin Brewer and the opportunity to do something on a little bit more of a national scale, supporting parents, creating resources, just sort of being a landing place for when people encounter this issue and they don't know how to navigate it. Hopefully they can come to us and find some resources for navigating. One of the things I think we do pretty often is connecting people. Somebody will email us and say, I've got this friend who their child just came out as transgender. You know, what do we do? Oh, you're in Ohio. Let me connect you with the Cardinal Support Network. Just doing anything we can to help people navigate this.
Who are the constituents or followers of your organizations? Who reaches out to you? Who reads your site? Who can benefit from the materials that you guys offer? Erin and Maria, go first.
I would suggest that pretty much everybody can benefit from something on our site because we have so many different kinds of resources. But as far as who reaches out to us, it's just heartbreaking. I was on the phone for about an hour and a half yesterday with a dad who's dealing with this issue. Maria and I both spend so much time with a lot of parents who are just completely overwhelmed as they're, you know, otherwise healthy, emotionally sound child comes home one day and says that, you know, they want to take puberty blockers and cross-sex hormones. They hate who they are. They don't want their name anymore. They're, you know, they want to be recognized as the opposite sex. And these parents are just completely taken by surprise because these are kids who don't have any history of gender dysphoria. So that's one group. I also work with a lot of legislators and community activists doing legislation to try and stop these medical interventions and to also prevent the therapy bans that are being enacted. And so I spend a fair amount of time talking to legislators and community members and just doing outreach, just trying to reach people. But we have all kinds of people contact us. We've had therapists contact us, doctors, people who work at universities saying, oh my gosh, what is happening? This ideology is insane. And Maria has a lot of experience talking to people as well.
Yeah Maria, go ahead. I feel like you have a special group of people that you tend to talk to a lot.
Yeah, a lot of time it's parents. I just 2 days ago had a parent reach out to me. And very often when parents reach out to us, they're new. We get the whole spiel about my child says that he is transgender and I want to support him and I want to give him all of the support that I can. And I love him and I accept him the way he is. I just have a couple questions. And then we find out it's a girl. And the girl came home and said she wants to be a boy. And this parent has been bullied by everybody, by the school counselor, the pediatrician, the principal, her friend group. Everybody has said, you must affirm this or the child's going to commit suicide. We get that all the time. And this mom I introduced her to, we have a group of parents online, and she posted in the group, she said, I am crying right now because this is the first time I've thought I'm not crazy. This is the first time someone has told me I don't have to affirm this. And I wish I could say that was rare, but this is a really common occurrence, is getting those phone calls, those emails.
So listen, Ruth Institute followers, as you're listening to this, if you know people who are in this situation, they need to come to Lake Charles, okay? Mm-hmm. It's fine to listen online. It's fine to, to do online resources and talk on the phone and all that. But you need to be in the room with people who can support you. Mm-hmm. There's no substitute for that real experience, the live experience. And I know Maria and Erin are going to be delighted to see you and talk with you. And you're going to feel so good when you see these ladies because they're the real deal. Dr. Van Meter, let's talk about the pediatricians. You all know who reaches out to the American College of Pediatrician subsidiary of the hate group club, because we are all so terrible people. We're like the second coming of the Ku Klux Klan, you and me, because we don't go along with this line. Who reaches out to you, Dr. Van Meter?
Parents will actually call from around the United States, just say, hey, my child is expressing the desire to become the opposite sex, and I don't know what to do. You know, to whom do I turn? And, you know, we have the resources such as Erin and his group to say, hey, we have some folks that, and we also may, depending on where they live, may know of a particular counselor who is already on our list from the American College, who has agreed to accept patients by Zoom conference and by phone to kind of run through a really decent and thorough psychological evaluation. Pediatricians are bullied by their organization. They're bullied by journal articles that come out in the journals they respect, the journal Pediatrics, the Journal of Pediatrics, JAMA Pediatrics Journal. These are things that come to pediatricians and they are full. Almost every month there's an article, if not two articles, proclaiming the glory and justification for affirmation of these, and with, you know, data that has hundreds of thousands of patients that they claim to be following, when really all they are is convenient samples of the Trevor Project survey system. And so, I mean, JAMA came out this week, JAMA Pediatrics came out with an article citing that they had over 1.5 million individuals they'd surveyed, and they were talking about the harms, the irreparable harms of care for these kids who were either same-sex attracted or transgender, and that we were trying to convert them, that this is called conversion therapy, to keep them to align with their biologic sex. Is somehow called conversion, but they love that pejorative term that they've described. They open the article, as they always do, with talking about shock therapy, electrical connection to the nipples and genitalia to get evil thoughts to go away, as if we're some barbaric medieval caretakers who are essentially trying to drive away the evil spirits with mechanics or prayer. And that, of course, it is always harmful. It's always been harmful, according to them. And they just glibly quote studies that are absolutely hideous, that have no ability to draw the conclusions they do, and condemn what is really the most effective therapy, particularly for transgender, and that is evaluation of mental health and ongoing treatment of mental health issues. The European countries, which were, way ahead of us by a good decade in affirmation, have come to the conclusion after 10 years ahead of us, saying the medical treatments and the surgical treatments are harmful, way more harmful than beneficial, effective immediately in Sweden, in Denmark, in France, and the UK. There will be no more affirmation of any kind of somebody under the age of consent, period, end of sentence, government edict. Instead, we will focus on mental health counseling. So Europe has been where we are, but we are stupidly and blindly going warp speed 180 degrees in the opposite direction, opening more and more transgender clinics at university centers, allowing Planned Parenthood the opportunity to essentially quadruple the available treatment centers for cross-sex hormones, and allowing online consortiums such as plume.com to offer hormone therapy over a video conference with no it's just more and more suck them in. It is horrific. It's an industry that is evil and harmful, and it's just burgeoning on this continent, and everyone else in the world except us is waking up and agreeing with what we believe in, which is do no harm, which we do know that medical therapies and surgical therapies clearly do harm that is so far beyond the pale, and that this myth of suicide is exactly that. It is a myth that bullies parents into acquiescing and signing consent forms.
And it's just shocking to me that we're on the heels. We still haven't recovered from the opioid crisis. And we hear these people say, well, the doctors say that they need this, so we better do it, without even questioning. And when we look at, all the harm that came out of doctors, willy-nilly giving away opioids, we still are having, people dying and, addictions. And it's just horrific. And now we have the same people saying, trust the doctors. They know what they're doing. And they're just handing out these hormones. And Dr. Van Meter, maybe you can address this, but this is something that I always like to get out there, that pretty much any female, any woman, any teenage girl, any prepubescent girl who starts taking testosterone is going to feel like $1 million, in the same way that the opioids made people feel better. And I don't know if you can address that or not, but that's something that I think is so important for people to realize, is that initially these interventions do make people feel really, really good. But that doesn't mean that they're appropriate interventions.
I said, has anybody raised toddlers in this room? And they all kind of go, oh, I see what you're getting to. Toddlers always are consistent, persistent, and insistent. And we do not let them take the screwdriver and put it into the outlet in the wall because they are consistent, persistent, and insistent. We finally, if necessary, have to smack them on the back of their hand and take the screwdriver away and say no. You know, you don't give in just because someone's persistent, consistent, and insistent. That doesn't, you know, why wouldn't we give BMWs to every teenager that wanted one because they threatened suicide if we wouldn't buy them a BMW?
Well, and that suicide threat in and of itself is so dangerous because we're teaching a whole generation that if they don't get what they want, the appropriate response is to threaten suicide. And I can't think of anything that undermines these kids' ability to be successful and grow up and be, you know, emotionally stable than to teach them that that's the appropriate response to not getting what they want.
Well, and we hear that all the time. We hear that from parents that I'm afraid to not affirm because they might commit suicide. It is such an emotional manipulation. And Dr. J, I'm sorry I cut you off there.
Well, you know, this conversation amongst the three of you, this is really interesting. And I think it's interesting and helpful for people to see. This is the kind of thing that takes place on a Q&A panel. But I want to take a moment and just say what each of you are going to be doing at the summit. Each of the three of you are going to be doing something a little bit different. We are giving an award to Erin and Maria jointly for the organization that they founded, and they are going to be awarded the Activist of the Year. And the way that works is that Friday night at the banquet, we have several awards that we give, and they are one of them. The keynote speaker will be Kristen Hawkins of the Students for Life of America, and she will receive the Pro-Life Leadership Award. We're so excited about having Kristen there because, of course, her star has kind of risen with the leaks from the Supreme Court and all the other things, and the Dobbs case is in the middle of everything and so on. So it's going to be a blast having Kristen there for the keynote speech. But what we always do on Friday night is we introduce the people who are receiving the award, the other awards, and we interview them for a few minutes, kind of, I don't know, Oprah style or something, you might say. You know, you're sitting in the chair and, you know, we chit chat a little bit. And then the following day, on Saturday, the two of you will be giving a whole presentation on activism for the defense of the body. So why don't you tell us just a little bit about, you know, how does it feel? How does it feel to win an award? And what you guys are especially looking forward to?
It's a huge honor. It is really an honor. I'm just excited about coming back again. I learned a lot at the Ruth Institute Summit last year. I came to it really thinking like, well, I know this. I know all this stuff. And the speakers that were there, I learned so much from. So I'm looking forward to coming and just getting a broader view of everything. And just getting to spend time with people who are like-minded and who all understand what's going on. So thank you very much for this honor and for the chance to get to come back again.
Erin, how about you?
Well, I was overwhelmed when you called and said that you were going to give us this award. I feel like we are in the company of giants. And so it is a huge honor. And I'm hoping that while I'm there, I can motivate people to get involved. I never thought I would get an award like this. And honestly, the reason I'm involved in this is because about 4 years ago, I guess, I feel like I was called to go testify at a hearing, and I'd never done anything like it. I went by myself and went and testified and told about my story of being a trans-identified kid, and that just catapulted me into this movement. And I want people to come to the Ruth Institute and learn that they too can get involved, that we need your voices. We need you to get involved. And it isn't that hard, that there's so many right. different ways that people can get involved. And coming to the Ruth Institute is a great way to do it because you will learn so much and you'll make so many connections. The people who are there are just wonderful.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a fact. I have cool friends. There's no doubt about that. I definitely have cool friends. And the thing that I like to point out to is point out to people is the wide variety of ways that people are involved. You know, I mean, there's something for everyone. You know, you don't have to be the kind of person who loves to be in front of the microphone. If you are, there are things you can do. If you aren't, there are still things you can do. You know, there are people who need to have someone to talk with them one-on-one privately. And for some people, that's a real vocation and a real calling. And so, you know, we hope to inspire everybody to find their niche, whatever that might be, and to become more effective at it. Dr. Van Meter, now you have an interesting role in this year's summit. Tell people what, we're playing you in two positions this year. Tell people what you'll be doing on Friday
Well, I'll be talking about the sort of the history and the, of the concept of society and the family, and how the American family has been under attack in its various, the various kinds of things that have happened since the 70s, and how it eventually harms children and is perhaps purposefully trying to take down the family to make sure that a political agenda can be imposed on the country, and we would go off in the direction of Marxism and government control, and the dissolution of the family is very necessary for that to happen. And so I'm going to kind of historically going to go backwards to forwards and kind of put this all together as a sort of a scenario historically, so you can see where it came from.
So Dr. Van Meter will be talking twice. On Friday, he'll be part of what we call the core training. The core training is a set of lectures that you can participate in and get the core ideas of the Ruth Institute. And so at that time, I'll be given a thing on the sexual understanding the sexual revolution, big picture kind of thing. Father Paul Sullins will be giving a talk on counting the casualties. He's a sociologist, and he'll just be kind of going through some of the different kinds of people who have been harmed that you can see in sociological data. Mm-hmm. And then Dr. Van Meter is going to talk about some of the medical costs associated with the sexual revolution and the ways that the body has been harmed. And then finally, my colleague Don Fetter is going to talk about demographic winter and the long-term consequences of fertility decline, population decline, and that we are not overpopulated, that we never were really, but just some of the problems associated with that. Go ahead, Dr. Van Meter. You looked like you're going to say something.
No, I was listening. I'm so excited about all the panel of speakers that are around me. They are giants in the field. Paul Sullins was there last year, and he has been very busy promoting his very, very sound study on conversion therapy, so-called, and the myths thereof.
Right.
And it is a very timely thing. This is a battle that needs to be won for the sake of humanity.
Yes.
And for the health of everyone. And so, it's eye-opening to be able to see people coming from the various disciplines and presenting their sort of worldview and wedge of how they, and you realize it's all intertwined. We are driven by the hope that humanity will come forward as an intact, faithful, faith-driven, moral society. That we do need that, and that will save our world.
And that we're in the process of losing science. Yes. Last year at the summit, that was very apparent because we were talking about the loss of the professions and the corruption of the professions. Mm-hmm. This year we're doing something that, a little bit different focus, but still, I think it's clear to a lot of people that we're losing science. Now, the other place we're playing you, and I think this is the talk you were mentioning before, yeah. The very last panel of the summit is going to be called Healing the Family. And we're really looking at some of the very specific things people can do to help specific things. So we have a young couple who'll be talking about their program to help children of divorce. Mrs. Lori Hoy, wife of Reverend Walter Hoy, she'll be talking about healing the post-abortive congregation because she mentioned that last year when she was at the summit and everyone wanted to hear more, so we're bringing Lori back, and we told Walter he could come too if he behaved himself, but we really wanted to hear from Lori this year. and then you, Dr. Van Meter, are going to talk about how kids really do need their parents and, basic things like that, right?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Things we would assume, and that would be unquestionable. And yet they're in this day and age, the bigotry and racism fingers pointed at you should you even begin to suggest such things. And we have to deflate that myth and come back up strong on another side. With all of our resources behind us, we need so many people to help us explain to the world to get back onto a foundation that we're fixing to be knocked off of. And that's
right.
It's a scary situation.
Well, I like the way you put it, because you can think of the family structure, the family system, as kind of a social sexual system that creates the rules by which everybody plays the game. So you've got an economic system over here, it's a capitalist system, or you got a socialist system over here. If you're playing under one set of rules, you're gonna behave very differently than if you're playing under the other set of rules. And what's happened to us is the the traditional Christian sexual ethic is being pushed aside to make room for a new structure, which says everybody can have all the sex they want and nothing bad will ever happen. And by the way, if anything bad ever happens, it's your own fault. And by the way, we need more propaganda and more power to solve that problem, because but there's nothing wrong with our underlying premise. Everybody does get to do whatever they want and everything will be fine. You know, that those two systems cannot coexist, right? And their structures, and this is what you two are dealing with, I think, there are structures that govern everybody's decision-making, incentives, thought process, you know, and one system will push out the other.
Well, I think one of the things that we've really finally, you know, gotten is that what's happening is that the state is now imposing a religion on us, that this ideology is so strong that I call it now a state religion, that we are being required to accept certain things, like that a child can be born in the wrong body, or that if a man says he's a woman, then he is a woman. These are, you know, very mystical ideas, and we're being told we have to accept these things, or as you mentioned, we're racist, we're bigots. I heard somebody presenting from CECAS, who's one of the big organizations pushing the comprehensive sexuality education program, saying that this is all grounded in white supremacy. And one of the things that's so helpful about the Ruth Institute Summit is that you can go there and you can learn how to counter these arguments. And the science is presented in a way that is very clear and cohesive, so that you can learn how to attack the methodological flaws in what they're presenting in their belief system, and show how what we're showing is actually grounded in very solid scientific ideas.
You know, you described it as a state religion, and you're not wrong. You know, you're not wrong about that. I call it a Gnostic death cult.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, because it. Yeah.
A kinder, gentler term, which...
Oh, come on, come on. Kinder and gentler? Come on. We're going to kick you out of the hate group, man. You can't. What is this kind and gentle thing?
I know. The point being, if we are going to explain it to a way that they might actually listen and not plug their ears, is secular humanism is their religion. And that is actually the foundation of what needs to be there for Marxism to flourish. It is that the human being is in charge of themselves and they are the center of the universe. There is no need for a God to have set the rules of ethics and morals and to have created science through natural law. You can create anything you please, and it is your right to do so. And what the consequences are, whatever they're going to be, and you just sort of deal with them as they come along. That is actually a religion unto itself, which is now being challenged in the district court of Washington, D.C., by six ex-gay adult males who are in the profession of law and counseling, and also some religious practices as well. And they have sued the federal government, and on the basis of they are imposing a religion on. And they cannot do that because the Constitution forbids it.
Because these are metaphysical claims that are being made.
Absolutely.
And they're being just simply asserted as if they're self-evident, and they're not. Yeah.
Well, and we're seeing this in the schools as well, is that kids are being required. I mean, the way I was describing this to my daughter, if you're in the public schools, you either agree with the politics, you lie about what you believe, or you're an activist. There's really no other option for kids in the public schools now when it comes to these issues. Kids
what
are
do you mean
being
by, forced. What do you mean by an activist? Activist on behalf of the cause or?
No, against it. If you're going to stand against it, you're going to be fighting an activist fight every day in school.
I see.
Yeah.
And so a lot of parents are saying to themselves, it's not fair for my kid to be the tip of the spear and something like that. And that's why the growth in homeschooling and all the rest of it. You know, one of the things we're doing this year that's a little different from last year, you guys, is that I'm going to do a talk first thing Saturday morning. And it's going to be a 15-minute talk, which I'm going to tee up this way. I'm going to say the pro-life movement succeeded by continuing to keep the humanity of the child in the womb front and center. And A lot of people were able to make that case. And one way they could make that case is there was this guy called Dr. Jack Wilkie, whom you may remember, Dr. Van Meter, I don't know, but the old time pro-life people will tell you about Dr. Jack Wilkie, who had a slideshow that he made right around the time Roe, he was in the pro-life movement before Roe, okay? And so when Roe v. Wade came down, he did not hang his head and say, oh, well, I guess the church will just have to accept abortion. He created a slideshow showing fetal development, and he gave that slideshow to all sorts of people. Hundreds of people used Dr. Wilkie's slides to explain the humanity of the child in the womb. So I'm going to do a presentation defending traditional Christian sexual ethics in 15 minutes, and you'll get the slides. Everybody who comes is going to get a jump drive that's going to have the slides on it, the script, and you can give this talk. And what we're going to come to is this whole racist point, you know, which is that the traditional Christian sexual ethic doesn't guarantee, but it creates the conditions for every child to have a mother and a father. No matter how rich, no matter how poor, every child has a mother and a father. And even the poor kids, even the rich kid, the white kids, black kids, every child, that's their birthright, to have a mother and a father. And a lot of black people agree with that. Believe you me, a lot of black people are fed up with their civil rights movement and their civil rights rhetoric being dragooned into the service of the trans agenda. You know, and some of those people are going to be there at our event because, you know, they've had enough of that. But anyway, that's something new. You know, we'll be giving out that that talk so that you can defend your values like a pro. That's where we want you to end up by the end of the summit. So
I came away last year as my first summit visit with handfuls of books and email addresses and phone numbers. And I have had a wealth of opportunities in this past year that would not have happened had I not come to the Ruth Institute meeting last year. As a presenter, I was more audience than presenter. I was in awe of the quality of the speakers and learned, you know, things that I had maybe had a thought about, but I didn't see how they were all related, and everything is so profoundly tied together. It is an uplifting experience. You kind of go home and you want to talk for hours to whoever will listen. are you done yet? I mean, I'm excited. But, you know, we have to have dinner. You know?
we're bringing some new people this year, and we're having some of the people from last year also coming back. Walt Heyer is coming back. We'll be giving an award to Walt Heyer. One of the people who's different this year is the person that receiving the Scholar of the Year award is a political philosopher named Scott Yenner, who's written a couple of books of history of political philosophy, explaining just how modern philosophy, political philosophy, has lost its mind and has no idea what to do with the family, you know. And he goes and looks at Hobbes and Locke and Simone de Beauvoir and Jean-Jacques Rousseau and all these people. And shows, you know, they don't get the family, they don't get love, they don't get marriage. They're all about individuals, you know, the autonomous individual. And I tell you, years ago when we had a college student program, we used to do a college student program every year, and we had Dr. Yenner speak at the very last one we had. Dr. Yenner came, and by the time he was done with those kids, they just all beelined over to buy his book because you think it's arcane. But it's really to the point what he has to say. So I'm excited about Dr. Yenner coming. Right. That's going to be a new big plus for everybody. Somebody else for you guys to know.
Yeah,
somebody else.
I want to give a shout out. I want to give a shout out to Walt Heyer because he's been doing this for so long. You know, he's been out there telling his story, trying to stop what's happening to children. And the first time I met him was in Alabama, and we were testifying on some legislation to try and stop these medical interventions. And a trans activist, after the hearing was over, threatened to kill Walt. Oh. And he deals with this on a regular basis because he's so public, because he's, you know, he's been advocating so strongly for this. And that's something that I think people need to understand, is that the other side talks about tolerance and love and diversity, but it's a lie. It's all part of this lie. It's all part of the way they've turned everything on its head. Loving, tolerant people don't threaten to kill those who they disagree with. And Walt is one of the most gentle, kind people you could possibly meet. If people are motivated to make threats like that, then we really have to question what is the underpinnings of this ideology and really poke holes in the idea that it's about tolerance and diversity. It's about, it's, you know, anything but about tolerance and diversity. It's about imposing their ideology on everybody. And if you don't accept it, you will comply or they'll make your life very difficult.
Well, and you know, it's the trans ideology has made it very clear that the sexual revolution is a top-down thing promoted by the elites. It's never been a grassroots movement. You know, you can't point to a single phase of it that was ever a popular demand for no-fault divorce. That's just not true. You know, there was no popular demand for abortion, ever. And I talk about that in the sexual state. So you're completely right about that. The other thing I want to just point out about Walt is that I am sure he's a hero to a lot of people. He's an underground hero in this whole area. And I just want to tell you guys, he's 81 years old. If you want to see him in person, you should show up. Okay. He's in good health. He's in good spirits, but he's 81 years old. You should show up and shake his hand and get your picture taken with him and thank him. Thank him for what he's doing. You know, that's all another reason why you should come and lay eyes on the guy in person. You can't do that over Zoom. You know, I mean, it's fun being on Zoom, everybody, but you know, if you want to shake the guy's hand, you got to come. So, as we come to close, as we come to the end of our time, could each of you tell people where they can find your particular organization if they'd like to learn more about your organization? Maria, you go first.
We are Advocates Protecting Children. You can find us at advocatesprotectingchildren.org or send us an email to advocatesprotectingchildren@gmail.com.
And mention your book that you've written.
Well, we have several. We have several of them. Mine is Desist, Detrans, and Detox, Getting Your Child Out of the Gender Cult. It's for parents who've been blindsided by this, and it's a safer path than affirmation. Erin has Transing Our Children. I'll let you talk about that and about your other book.
I also want to mention that we do have a YouTube station and lots of videos on there. We have something called Common Sense Care, which is a video series that we did talking about, you know, all these different aspects for parents who have been blindsided by it. And in time for the Ruth Institute, we're going to have transcripts from the Common Sense Care series available. So we're really excited about that. As Maria mentioned, I have a book called Transing Our Kids that Maria and I worked on together. And it is kind of a primer for people who really don't know what's going on and who need to get up to speed without a lot of heavy reading. And the last book is called Always Erin, which is a book about my childhood experience with a transgender identity. And it's for caregivers, for therapists, and teachers, and potentially for children who are struggling with difficult feelings related to their gender identity or struggling with gender dysphoria or body dysmorphia.
It's an illustrated children's book, and it's charming. It's really good. I think it's great. And also, don't you guys have some curriculum, some Sunday school or church based curriculum? Why don't you mention that real quick?
We have a K-5 curriculum. It's just a single lesson plan for churches to employ. There's a K in first grade, second, third, fourth, and fifth grade, and it just deals with God created males and females. That's all. Some people don't know that, and they may tell you something different, but they're telling you something that's not true, and that God created you exactly the way he wants you to be as a boy or a girl. It's just those three objectives. And we also have a new book called Gentle Leadings. It's a devotional book for parents who are going through this. And it was written under a pseudonym by a parent who's been through this. And she has put together 60 days, I think, of devotionals for parents who are struggling with this.
So you can see why I'm giving these ladies an award, people. They're hyperactive. You can't stop them. So Dr. Van Meter, where can people find the American College of Pediatricians?
Well, our website is www.acpeds.org or www.best4children.org. They'll get you to the same place. If you Google American College of Pediatricians, the first thing that will pop up, unfortunately, is a Wikipedia entry, which describes us as a hate and bigoted group of crazy right-wing Southern religious zealots who are anti-everything.
And then you'll get the Southern Poverty Law Center.
Right. So it's you know, that's not the way to find us. I mean, I would go to www.bestforchildren.org or www.acpeds.org. Feel free. It's built for you to come and see who we are, to find pediatricians in your region for resources, to look at all of the things that we have in the way of position papers. We've just buffed up and we're revising our teenage brain under construction paper, which explains why adolescents should not be allowed to make decisions. Actually, up to age 25, it's a little dicey in terms of what the frontal lobe is capable of doing for looking ahead and seeing consequences of behaviors and decisions. So it's beautifully based in science. It's compassionate. It's non-discriminatory. We welcome everybody who would wish to be supportive as donors and members and friends of the college. We will flourish if we are supported. And so we are always interested in finding people with the means to help support us, you know, chip in and come to know us and get our monthly newsletters. And we're happy to have all those folks that we'll see in the Lake Charles maybe become members of our organization.
That's great. Yeah, that's great. And if you know a doctor, if you know a pediatrician, by all means, tell your family doctor about the American College of Pediatricians, for sure. My final question for each of you is if you could just tell our viewers, tell our listeners why they should come. Just give people one last reason why they should come to Lake Charles, Louisiana on June 24th and 25th. Let's start with Maria.
You should definitely come to the Ruth Institute Summit because you will learn far more than you ever imagined. You will go home better prepared for having conversations, difficult conversations. You'll come away equipped for making real change.
Thanks, Maria. Erin, what about you?
Well, and you mentioned shaking Walt Heyer's hand, but also the opportunity to shake your hand, Dr. J, and Dr. Quentin Van Meter's hand, and Maria Keffler's hand. The summit is intimate enough that you really will get a chance to talk with people who have really important insights about these issues. And that's one of the things that I really like about it. It's not one of these, you know, thousands of people's conference where you can maybe we'll see somebody walking down the hall, but you won't get a chance to talk to them. The Ruth Institute Summit is intimate enough, and it's designed to have breaks so that people can go and talk to the others. And I ended up having a couple of conversations with Dr. Van Meter at the last summit, and it was wonderful to be able to just sit down over a cup of coffee and chat with some of these great minds.
Dr. Van Meter, you already said some great things about your experience, but do you have any parting shots for people?
Well, I would say that the Ruth Institute staff is as accommodating and welcoming as any that you'll ever find. The food is Louisiana good cooking from the start to finish. You can't really beat that. It's hard to find such wonderful things in all in the same place. But they literally, the meeting is set up so that it is for you to benefit. The staff bends over backwards. The hospitality is stunning. It's all part of the body of what Ruth Institute is. And it's good-hearted, incredibly inspiring. And that's, I just put it that way.
I will just, I'll just add, thank you for mentioning the food. That was the best bread pudding I have ever had in my life. I would come back just for that bread pudding, even if nothing else.
It's true. We have the best food in America.
Really do.
We're a bunch of rednecks and good old boys, but those good old boys can cook. Let me tell you.
Oh, they can cook.
That is a fact. We've got great people and great content, and we want everybody to benefit from it. But we do have things set up so you're going to be able to. We have plenty of time built into the schedule. We have plenty of room around the table so you're not crammed together in a food line. And, you know, just a number of things that we've thought of to try to make it conducive to conversation and building good friendships and good relationships. And so to all the Ruth Institute followers, if you are watching all the way to the end, that is stupendous, because most people don't watch things all the way to the end on YouTube. And so I just would like to welcome you to come to Lake Charles on June 24th and 25th. If you're watching this a year from now or 2 years from now, because our videos do get watched for a long time, the videos will be online and you can see them, but you really definitely want to come and get acquainted with all these people and get the energy. I think you can feel the energy that takes place when like-minded people of goodwill get together around a common objective. And we're really looking forward to seeing all of you in Lake Charles, Louisiana, June 24th and 25th. All right.
We get
Padre. Okay. Padre, what do you say? Is that a wrap or what?
I hope I didn't miss.
It was a wrap. All right. Great. I'm going to turn off the recording. Thank you.
Does transgenderism and the gay takeover of public schools appall you? Get the tools to fight for your family and the well-being of all children at the Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution this June 24th and 25th in Lake Charles, Louisiana. Hear expert testimony from those who left the gay and transgender lifestyles. Visit summitforsurvivors.org for more details.
Hi, I'm Matt Maddox, the Digital Marketing Director at the Ruth Institute. Join us this 24th and 25th of June in Lake Charles, Louisiana, as we fight for family. You'll get expert testimony based on solid scientific research. You'll get clear thinking, and you'll hear the stories of the survivors, all of which will empower you to protect your family and help your children and community achieve their divine potential. We can't wait to see you there.